So, 2 months ago I discovered my new favourite channel on the YouTubes called Skip and Shannon Undisputed, a channel and show where Skip Bayless and Shannon Sharp, two well-known pundits of American sports, discuss and debate topics like a lot of shows have done since the dawn of television, and man discovered that two people arguing is entertaining. Add sports to that and suddenly schmucks like me are hooked. And there are many more layers to this show, like the genuine chemistry and friendship of the two stars coupled with their unique perspectives on life and sport. But the reason I've brought this show up to you guys is because whilst watching this channel I had a bit of a eureka moment, where I had the realization that American sports are so much more detailed in their discussion about the mental side of their sports. Please allow me to explain further as we discuss the mental side of rugby. Now, American broadcasters' obsession with the mental side of their sports is fascinating to me, and I thought to myself, why don't rugby take more of a look at the psychological side of the game? In fact, why don't most sports take more of a keen interest into this side of their sports? Then I got to thinking, I wonder why this happens more in American sports. Could it be the American sports journalists and media's constant search for narratives and stories to make the game even more interesting than it already is, giving us fans storylines to connect with the players and the teams, in a similar way to how any interesting boxing match has some sort of history or tension attached to it? Could it be America's obsession with winning and finding out what drives these people, who have to be both an exceptional human with drive and talent to make a name for themselves in a country with so much competition, and then on top of that, the drive to get themselves to new heights with an almost psychotic obsession with success and winning? Or could it be how most top sports in America are excellent vehicles for individuals to stand up and be noticed, making big plays or being clutch? I'm very down with the terminology now, guys. Be impressed. You're welcome. Anyway, whatever it is that has brought the conversation of mental strength and fragility to the table, it's a good thing and it needs to continue, as they have already got through the hardest barrier, which is getting the conversation started, which unfortunately in rugby is taking a while. Rugby union as a sport is in a slightly weird position when it comes to mental health and the psychological side of the sport. If you talk to most professional sports people who play at the highest level of whatever game they play, and you ask them how much of the game is mental and how much of it is physical, most of them say it's around 50-50, which at least to me, and I know I'm stating the obvious here, is a massive percentage. I'm not the first person to say this either in the rugby sphere, but it all seems to either fall on deaf ears or be acknowledged in a window dressy, shallow kind of way. For example, when I was at the Wasps Academy, one day in preseason we had a psychologist come in and talk to us, and in my head I'm thinking, oh, this is amazing, as I had a lot of things I wanted to speak to her about, but it wasn't like that. I think she did one session with us as a group, one with about 8 guys filling out forms on how certain situations made us feel, which is fine, and I should be grateful that they even brought someone in the first place, but it barely scratches the surface, because nobody really is properly going to open up in front of their teammates, especially when you're at under 18s. But there's so much to get into mentally when you're at that age in your rugby development. For example, trying to deal with the complex emotions of feeling like this is your one shot to make it, and trying to perform every day at every session so you can get a contract. Also the fact that once you get into the serious professional side of rugby, coaches aren't there to be your friend slash mentor slash guide. They are there to get results, so they are under pressure to find the next star for their club, and that pressure they're under means that they're going to put pressure on you to be the best you can be, and a lot of the time the methods are not pleasant, meaning that that's going to be playing on these players' minds as well. I know it was for me, and I don't think I ever got the best out of myself in that environment because I was always so nervous about making a mistake. And the mental part of the game of rugby, your state of mind when you go on the field, is all about inches. That hesitation or that willingness to act in the moment is key, and it makes all the difference when it counts. I've played with guys who are incredible in training when the pressure is off, but suddenly are shells of themselves in a proper game. I think I include myself in that sometimes. And what you might be wondering is, what can players do to help themselves when these sort of things are going through their minds? Well, according to Google, when I searched how to cope with the performance issues, the NHS had some very helpful advice that I will take on board. Then after I slightly reworded what I meant to say, I stumbled on a few articles that unfortunately said a lot of the same things, some of them useful and some of them, let me just show you. The first one that's always there is be prepared, practice, 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 which I think is an often underutilized way of building your confidence and belief in your own abilities. Johnny Wilkinson, my hero and of course yours, used to practice his goal kicking for insane amounts of time during the week so that he could eliminate any variables, any elements of chance that may not go his way, which is a very extreme but very effective way of trying to lessen your performance anxiety. So that's a good one, but after that they just sort of get very generic. Things like think positive thoughts, eat properly, be yourself, etc, etc. It's just all a bit... So in my opinion, there is only one real way to help players through these sorts of things. Therapy. Now, it doesn't always have to be this serious. A change of environment can have a massive impact on the way you see things, especially if you find yourself in the one that makes you particularly uncomfortable. But I believe therapy is the only real tangible thing that can help players get the edge they need. Now, the phrase having the edge mentally is a phrase that gets thrown around a lot in sport, especially rugby, without a lot of care for what the actual details entail or mean. And it is a slightly weird abstract thing to explain in words, but the best quote-unquote explanation I've ever seen of it was by Mike Ford in the rugby DVD, Swing Low Sweet Chariot 2, not number 1, where England were winning everything, no, part 2, where Brian Ashton's just taken over and things are just going wrong all the time. As a side note, I find DVDs like this more insightful than the ones where teams are winning all the time. You can learn way more about a sport seeing things going wrong than when they're going fine. Anyway, halfway through the documentary, England are playing Ireland at Croke Park. Before the game, England are warned about how emotionally fired up the Irish will be at this ground because of the history of the stadium by Conor O'Shea. And naturally, England take this warning to heart and get royally thumped by the Irish in that game that I can remember watching live to this day because of how sad it made me and how memorable David Strel's hair was. I mean, meow. Sorry, back to the point. I'm getting there, I promise. After the game, the team are in a video session and Mike Ford has a right go at the players about how he shouldn't have to talk to international players about having the edge. And the example he uses for this is when one of the England players tackles an Irishman in the air and how all the Ireland players crowd around the player, then crowd around the referee. He narrates it, talking about the desire to win and how in that moment they had collective mental focus. And that's the best way I can describe the edge to people. It's sort of being clued in and almost being willing to do whatever it takes to win, and it translates across all sports. In basketball, Kobe Bryant was always referred to as the Black Mamba, a killer with Mamba mentality who would do anything to win. Examples like this make me believe that mental strength is the key rather than physical strength to giving teams the edge going forward, as players are always going to be getting fitter and stronger. That's the nature of the beast, but it's in the strength of the human mind that we can unlock our potential in this sport, finding out the best ways to make people tick around our wonderful sport, as there must be something just a little bit sadistic in wanting to play this painful, painful game, especially if you play in the front five, which we will get to in another video. And I haven't even mentioned the role that therapy could have on mental illness in our sport. Kieran Mile wrote one of the most powerful articles I have ever read about his mental health whilst being a professional athlete, the stresses it takes on your body and your mind, and I'm sure he is not alone. Another high profile example of someone opening up in sport is Raheem Sterling. Now, I've always had a bit of a soft spot for Raheem Sterling. Maybe it's because we both grew up in Wembley. Maybe it's because our sisters knew each other. Or possibly because he shares my running style when I'm tired, which is a work of art, by the way. But I really connected with him around the 2014 World Cup, despite the whole tournament for England being an unmitigated disaster. But that year, Raheem Sterling, before the tournament, spoke about seeing a therapist to help him cope with his feelings of anxiety and depression, which had been affecting him both on and off the pitch. And through this and his hard work, he has now gone from being an underperforming prodigy to literally being one of the best players in the world. And I believe it's in the power of mindset and creating environments within our sport, both at amateur and professional level, that we can have players and people who do not need a coach to have an arm around them or to give them a kick up the backside to perform, but can get everything they need from themselves, at all age groups, wherever and whenever, depending on the individual. Now, I understand part of the reason that this hasn't caught on in the way that it probably should is financial. Like most good things humans create or make or do, it is at a premium and is sold as such. Therapy most of the time is no different, but I believe it's up to us to keep this conversation going so that those struggling mentally, be it anxiety or depression, can be given the best chance to be the best they can be. And I know I've only barely scratched the surface with this whole thing, and this video has sort of been all over the place like a bit of a mind map and a stream of consciousness, but I guess that's part of the beauty and kind of the difficult part of your mind. It's all over the place, and the more we can understand it, the better we will be as people and the better we will be at rugby, which is what really matters. I hope you guys have enjoyed this video, and I hope that the mental side of our game can continue to be a talking point and continue to grow. There's been the excellent Lift the Weight campaign talking about helping raise awareness for the mental side of playing in rugby, and I wish that there was more buzz around stuff like that, but I guess everything's a work in progress, but I hope progress can continue. Signed, NGJ.